This is a tale of two cities, Calcutta and Dundee. I'm a son of Dundee. It's the big constant in my life. I grew up here amid the clatter of the jute mills, where both my parents began their working lives. I'm on a journey into my own past and on to Calcutta in the footsteps of the Dundee jute workers who left to seek their fortunes in India.
That's called Dundee me, out Thundai. Salam hajur, ap kaisa hai.
Am dobi buddha ho gaya hai. Purana wala jute me lag me hai.
The Indians called jute the golden fiber, and for more than a century it bound together the fortunes of Dundee and Calcutta.
In 1883, in the North Sea, a migrating humpback whale took an unfortunate wrong turning and found itself sailing up here, the River Tay, towards the city of Dundee.
At that time, Dundee was the whaling capital of the United Kingdom. After an epic struggle, the whale was dragged ashore and paraded triumphantly through the streets, giving Dundee's army of jute mill workers a grandstand view of the oily sea monster that made their industry possible. Jute had been grown in northern India for thousands of years. It was a coarse fiber that could only be woven by hand. Then in 1838, a Dundee textile worker made an amazing discovery. Treating raw jute with whale oil made it machine workable. Dundee's industry was born. Today, only ghosts remain. But at its peak, the city's jute was as vital to the global exchange of goods as the internet now is to the exchange of information. Shipped from India and woven into Hessian sacks in Dundee, jute carried everything from cotton and coal to sugar and salt. It was strong and it was versatile. Carpets, sandbags, and even the tarpaulins for the American wagon trains were all made in the city's mills. Migrating workers arrived here in their thousands. By the end of the 19th century, Dundee had quadrupled in size. Many of the new arrivals came from rural Ireland. Dundee's Catholic churches were built with the pennies of these Irish poor, but it wasn't their religion that made them stand out. Three quarters of the city's mill workers were women. So Dundee became known as She Town.
You know, the men had worked in Ireland, they'd done the fields, and the women stayed at home. But the one thing they could do was they could spin and they could weave. And of course, that's what they needed in this town. They needed spinners and weavers. The men couldn't do that. The women could. And the children could. So you had child labor like nobody's business. And you had the most, you know, the women who actually was quite matriarchal. And the women were quite powerful. It's interesting that this is a women's group on a Sunday. And the tradition remains. It's quite a powerful tradition in Dundee.
Like most people from Dundee, my family history is bound up in jute. My great-grandparents came here from Sligo and Fermanagh at the time of the Irish famine. They found work in the mills of Camperdown and Hillbank, and some settled in Lochee, an area of the city known to this day as Little Tipperary. My big sister Betty still lives in the city. After my father died and my mother was ill, Betty took care of me.
Betty!
She is the official keeper of the family archive.
My mother worked in the mill between 19... just till she got married.
She was married when she was 23.
Yeah, but she was...
Oh, she worked in the mill before.
She worked in the mill before.
But she went
before.
Away to Canada, remember?
Oh, she went to Canada, that's right.
She went away to Canada.
She went on a service, that's right. She did. She got away. She had to get away from her drunken father. That was the problem. So she would have started when she was about 12.
Probably. Yeah. Probably.
My mother's memories of the mill were she was forced to go. Her father made her go, and as he made Auntie Cathy go as well.
That's how Auntie Jean got
out. And Auntie Jean ran away. My,
she went away to Walkerbuck.
Yeah, she did a runner.
That's
Dad.
Dumping, yeah.
That's my dad. Now, that would be the time he worked in the mill.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, it was. I suppose we were the lucky ones that we... I think that they saw the writing on the wall and they wanted to get out. Well, he's older, but I don't think he's much wiser. He hasn't changed. You can take the boy out of Dundee, but you can't take Dundee out of the boy.
My parents followed their parents into the mills, but the closest I got was as a wee boy peering through the doors of the Eagle Jute Works on a hot summer's day. I remember being dazzled by all the noise, the dust, and the activity. This is the Verdant Works Mill. 500 people used to work here. Now it's the Jute Museum. I'm here to meet former weaver Lily Thompson. Lily worked in the city's mills for 40 years, and she's still paying the price.
What was it like working in the mill?
Very, very noisy. Very, very dirty. And it was just a case of you just had to do it, whether you liked it or not. People were at the back of you all the time. Keep going, keep going.
Really? It was tough, huh?
Well, yeah. I had 6 machines to look after. So you just run from one to the other to the other. Never stopped.
How did you communicate with all the noise in the mill? I mean, how did you... I mean, did you talk to your fellow weavers and stuff?
Are you going out the night? What time is it? 2:05. 1:30. Or 2:45. You told the time of your hands.
You've lost your hearing, right?
Yes.
And you're just one of many.
Oh, yes. There's a lot of them, did it? An awful lot of people, too, would bother with their chests.
Yeah.
You know, they had chest trouble.
And how did you notice your deafness? How did you notice it happen? Or were you aware of it?
No, just gradually got aware of it and aware of it. I said, I'm not picking this up, I'm not picking that up.
Yeah.
That was it.
What was your opinion of the bosses?
Snobs. Oh, yeah. They didn't have time for the work. They never spoke to you. You know, they just never acknowledged us at all. You were just the worker. You were the underdogs, and that was it. This was for the foreman coming. And then if it was the big manager, that was the head man. He's coming. So you put your head down and you work like hard.
In the middle of the 19th century, Dundee's population grew by 30,000. Yet only a few hundred new houses were built. The cramped conditions took a heavy toll on the people's health, and come the start of the First World War, the majority of Dundonian men were considered too weak to fight, not even fit enough for cannon fodder.
As the mill workers scratched their meagre living, the jute barons amassed their vast fortune and built their houses away from the industrial squalor of Dundee, here in Broughty Ferry.
The area around Strathairn Road was the wealthiest square mile on the planet, a distinction it held to the rise of Hollywood at the beginning of the 20th century. But only 2 miles away, infant mortality was the worst in Scotland.
Oh, dear me. The world is ill divided. Them that work the hardest are the least provided. I'm unbide contented. Dark days are fine. There's nae much pleasure living. Often 10 and 9. Unbelievable.
That song was written by Mary Brooksbank, a communist jute worker enraged by the conditions in the mill. But the industry she railed against was already in gradual decline. As the jute barons tried to trump each other with the grandeur of their mills and embarked on a game of my chimney's bigger than your chimney, they failed to see that the world was changing. The balance of power in the global jute industry had shifted to Calcutta. Calcutta's first mill started working in 1855. By 1930, the city was producing 70% of the world's jute products, with a never-ending supply of raw materials right on its doorstep.
So if you wanted a future in jute, there was only one place to go, India.
Jai Hind!
This is Moneyfeith Golf Club. Tonight, it's hosting a meeting of the Calcutta and Mafussal Society, a club formed by veterans of India's jute industry.
A plate?
Something nice and Indian, yes.
The majority of Calcutta's mills were owned by expatriate British businessmen, but they were managed by Dundonians. Ambitious jute workers started to leave Dundee in the 1850s, and they ran the Calcutta industry for the best part of a century. These people were among the last jute wallers to make the trip.
Kesahai.
Kesahai.
Pani me.
Pani me.
Pani.
Oh, Pani. All right.
A pinnacle Pani.
It's the same Dundee, ni ice.
Ni ice.
I used to say to the bear, Dwai lo. Dwai is medicine, lo is fetch. Fetch the medicine bearer. And he'd bring me a whiskey and soda.
I would have been there long. There was a 30-year contract they had, but things started to go a bit wrong for the Europeans there.
All right. No, 1969, I came back.
You came back in 1969. How long were you out there for?
19 years.
I was over 10.
My first impressions of Calcutta were that it must have been badly hit during the war because it looked rather ramshackle.
It was the smell. I remember mostly about India.
And then I realised that that is how Calcutta looks anyway.
Some people didn't like the smell of India, but I did. Mm. You know, I took to India like a duck to water. I really enjoyed it.
One of you ladies got married in Calcutta, is that right?
Yeah, I did.
You did.
We did.
You got married in Calcutta.
We did.
It was a wee bit unsettled when I saw a man in the courier, mill clerk wanted for India. So I applied and got it.
But of course, this was the headquarters of jute in the world, really, Dundee. And hence they recruited from Dundee for the staff out there.
Walking down along Chowringhi on a Saturday, it was rather like walking down Dundee High Street with all the Dundee accents going.
The songs would be from the coolies, the coolie log loading up. They would sing, hey ho, the sabs are sala, hey ho, the sabs are sala, which means, of course, the sab is a bloody fool for me.
I went to school up in the hills, up in Darjeeling. I was very dark with the sun. And as I spoke Hindi fluently, I could easily be mistaken for an Indian.
It's something which is so intrinsic to the, not only the Dundonian nature, but the Scottish nature, which is this thing about travelling, this thing about adventure, this thing about going and finding out and adjusting. And it's quite humbling.
The jute wallers left Dundee for what they hoped would be a better life in India. I made my own escape from the city and from my parents' background by becoming an actor. And in a way, I identify with these people. I identify with their willingness to up sticks and head into the unknown.
I do love to drive on the horn here, don't I? The peep mad. Oh, there you are, there's another one. Different kind of peep.
I was last in Calcutta in the early 1980s on a British Council theatre tour. I was amazed by how many barges carrying jute there were on the Hooghly River. Then I noticed they all bore the names of mills from back home, Baxter's and the Eagle Works. It jolted me into making the connection between Dundee and Calcutta for the first time. The Hooghly River is as vibrant as it's ever been. Life's daily rituals are acted out in its holy waters, and it plays a major role in the story of Jute. Merchant ships would leave here bound for Dundee, and freshly arrived jute wallers would be whisked upstream to live and work in the mill compounds that lined the river's banks.
Let's say I arrived on the compound 11 o'clock in the morning. By 12 o'clock lunchtime, I was being measured for X pairs of pants, X shirts, double pockets, short sleeves. And by 8 o'clock that evening, I had them. I was ready for work the next day.
Calcutta was a cosmopolitan and vibrant city. Its cinemas and restaurants provided familiar refuge for culture-shocked Europeans. But the jute mills were 30 miles upriver. The world the Dundonians discovered here was a stark contrast to home. But life on the riverbank did have its comforts.
I had 8 servants for the house.
We had a bearer, a cook.
The bearer, he was more like the housekeeper and then the cook, so I didn't have to do anything.
A jamadar.
He did the floors in the bathrooms and walked a dog.
A coolie.
And the coolie, he did the dusting and made the beds and took the stuff to the laundry and back again.
And the driver.
They all had their jobs, yeah.
If you were of a certain status in Calcutta, if you didn't have 8 servants, you weren't worth contacting, you might say.
For young men in their early 20s, the change of lifestyle sometimes took a little getting used to.
You've got a bearer, you've got a guy looking after you, where you were used to selecting your own trousers, selecting your own shirt, selecting your tie. Your mother did your own laundry. But then you got this guy, he's laid it out, and you thought, said, does that tie really go with that shirt tonight, you know, sort of thing. And that was his choice. And you just did it. I mean, you had to please him as well as him pleasing you.
My father didn't even take off his... Well, he took off his underwear, probably, but he would come in from the mill and his chota peg would be at his hand side there on the chota, on the peg table. The radio would be on, BBC or something like that, and he would just put his foot out and his shoe and sock would be taken off, one in turn like that, and he would be tuning in and the bearer would unbutton his shirt and take that all off and hand him a light dressing gown. And his bath water would be laid, the soap would be there, the towel ready for him, the change of clothes all set for him. Whereas for the wives, very much more difficult, more trying, I think, for them, because most of them didn't even have a great deal in running their affairs or running the household affairs. They may have thought that, but they didn't. The bearer really was the boss.
For the women, it was just a life of leisure, really. Because you didn't have to do anything.
That was the biggest thing, not having much to do. You ordered the meals after breakfast time, and then what did you do for the rest of the day?
They were Scots, and the sun was shining. They did exactly what you'd expect them to do.
Somewhere beyond the sea, somewhere waiting for me, my lover stands on golden sands and watches the ships that go sailing. Somewhere beyond the sea, she's there watching for me. If I could fly like birds on high, then straight to her arms I'd go sailing.
Were very wild parties. The bearers would be all in their splendid livery with their puggrees and their cummerbunds, and the cooks would be all a fluster, and there'd be bottles of gin, whiskey, especially whiskey, all over the place. And the tennis would be good. It would end up with probably 50 or 60 people quite drunk in the pond, in the mill tank, in the swimming pool and all the rest of it.
You always knew when it had been a Masonic meeting during the week because there would be bodies, you know, on the tennis courts and so on.
But life for the peasant farmers who grew the jute wasn't so free and easy. I'm heading north into the rural villages to see for myself where the crop is grown. One of the first things that strikes you about the Bengal countryside is there are people everywhere. 90 million Bengalis live in an area a little bigger than Scotland. Dundee is starting to feel like an awfully long way away. This is not an easy place to be a Scotsman. Bengal has one of the most humid climates on the earth. The sun beats down on these fields with fierce intensity. The jute here is still in the early stages of planting. Luckily, local expert, Mr. Sahar, is on hand.
So, Mr. Sahar.
Yes.
All this is jute.
Jute.
Yeah. How long does it take to grow?
90 din theke 90 days to 100 days.
And how tall does it grow?
Up 6 feet to 7 feet.
Yeah, wow. Mm. So how many men at any given time do you have working in these fields, planting?
Mm.
10,000 people working?
10,000 people in this area, whole area.
Oh, the whole area?
Area.
Wow. Mm. Oh, what's this stuff over here? That doesn't look like jute. What is that?
Uttar dan ya hai mane oita badam ache ar ki jute dam ta idanin kom pacche bole ei je pater byabsha eta chashta komiye apnar badamer chashta korche era.
So jute is a low price and now you're working for peanuts. Amazing.
A recent rise in demand for eco-friendly jute products hasn't done much for Bengal's peasant farmers, who earn as little as 40 pence a day from the crop. Despite this, an astonishing 4 million families survive by growing jute. Mr. Sahar works for the Jute Corporation of India, an organization that protects the interests of the country's jute growers. In an effort to protect me, he invites me back to his office to escape the midday sun.
Mr. Brennan, take it.
Oh, thank you.
Jute product.
Jute?
Jute food. Leaves, from leaves.
What, I eat it?
Yes, jute leaves.
So, deep fried jute. Like, it's another thing they have in common with Dundee, deep-fried Mars bars, you know? No, you probably don't know anyway.
Jute lips food.
Here goes. Very nice. What's the difference between these?
A good quality jute in this area.
Right.
TD,
what is TD?
TD, Tosha Desi.
Tosha Desi.
Desi.
So jute. This is Tosha Desi, quality.
Quality. Desi.
And this is number four.
Number.
So I have to ask the question, what happened to one and two?
One and two?
No. Oh, one and two is in Bangladesh.
When India gained independence in 1947, Bengal was partitioned on religious grounds. Hindus were allocated the western half of the state and Muslims the east. The best quality jute grows in the east in what is now known as Bangladesh, tantalizingly out of reach of Calcutta's mills. The sectarian violence that accompanied partition was brutal and bloody.
Unspeakable atrocities were committed by both sides. Over 500,000 people lost their lives.
The riots were extremely severe around the compound. I have, in fact, witnessed myself people being killed in front of the house, oh yes, by lathi-wielding mobs, that's bamboos, Hindus and Muslims primarily. I do recall also the Hooghly at one time, almost full of bodies. And I can recall coming back and seeing a squad of men actually picking bodies off the filter cages. We were very fortunate people because we were in the mill, we had the compound surrounded by hefty walls, we had Gurkha guards, or Darwins as they called them, they were armed at the time. So we were very well off actually, very secure. But for the people outside, terrible, shocking time.
The Indian government issued a number of directives which said that by certain dates, progressively, more and more Indians should be employed in positions that Europeans were being employed in. Well, that was one aspect of Indianization.
A lot of the Jutewalas at the time, I have to watch what I say here, but they thought once they go, the expertise is gone, and the Indians, they'll never be able to run the mills at all, no chance. And before that happened, they thought, make an exit, get out of the place. So there was a sort of mass exodus, if you like, from India, especially the Bengal area.
It was eventually going to finish for the European, because the Indians were perfectly capable of running the mills. Sometimes not just as successfully, I mean, we can boast to that extent, but they could run the mills.
By the early 1950s, many of Calcutta's mills had passed into Indian ownership. The Marwaris, a business caste from Rajasthan, were the new ruling class. Marwaris had been involved in India's jute industry from the very start, but they still relied on Dandonians to manage their mills. The Jutewalas were now working closely with Indian colleagues, though in some of the more conservative mills, there were still lines that could not be crossed.
One of the staff at my mill was going with an Anglo-Indian girl. Now, I'm 26, 27 at the time, and I said, yes, that is correct, I know he is. Well, he says, what are you going to do about it? I said, well, what do you think I should really do about it? He says, well, I want you to put a stop to it. Now, here's me, and I knew the guy was 10, 15 years older than I am, and I said, but I can easily put a stop to it. I said, but what do you want me to do? Do I fire the guy? He says, if he doesn't do what you tell him to stop the association, you fire him. I said, that's all I want to know. So I phoned the manager. I said, I want so-and-so in the office at 6 o'clock tomorrow morning. I said, he'll know what it's about. And I just told him, I said, it's known that you have an association with this girl. He says, well, it's true. I said, what do you intend doing? He says, I'm going to marry the girl. I said, well, I'm here to fire you. You better pack your goods and off you go. Married the girl, came back and ran a newsagent shop in Dundee.
The cultural gap between the Jutewalas and their local workforce was huge. Many of the Dundonians who came to Calcutta in the 1950s had come out of the forces and were well suited to sacrificing their personal feelings for the company rule book. Not something I've ever excelled at myself.
So when the Dundonian jute managers arrived here, they were all given a copy of this book. It's called The Essentials of Colloquial Hindustani for Jute Mills and Workshops. They will have to show better work than this, or otherwise you will have to dismiss them. You must finish your work as soon as possible. You must not lose your ticket, or I will have to stop your money. There's a very formal relationship between worker and boss. It's also very clear by the language that the boss established very clearly who he is and who the worker is, that they are lesser than who I am. And this is encouraged. I mean, the whole tenor of this this little booklet is about you are a better person than the person that you're dealing with. Now, it's couched in a fairness, and it's couched in a sense of, you know, a levelness, but it's not really. It's really about, you know, you're there and I am here. This is very clear.
That edition of Colloquial Hindustani for Jute Mill Workers was printed in 1947, and it remained in use right up until the last of the Wallahs quit India in the mid-1960s. I'm on my way to Howrah Jute Mill to see what it's like for the Indian workers today. I'm also hoping to get a better sense of what working life was like for the Jute Wallahs and for those they left behind in the mills back home.
Oh, it's a temple.
It must be the Catholic in me. I can't pass an altar without praying.
Well, good luck. This is what I need. Maybe I should do a little prayer for good luck.
I get the impression that the Jute Wallahs like to think of Calcutta as a golden time in their lives. But the bottom line is, they were here to work.
You really worked hard out there. A lot of people maybe didn't think we did, and they thought we had a great time, but we were really hard-pressed at times.
Basically, your whole day was taken up with work. New Year's Day, that was the day off. Christmas Day, that was a normal working day.
But you got used to the heat and stuff like that. You just kept changing. Cross to the mill in the morning, 6 o'clock, home for breakfast, change, down to Calcutta, change, back up from Calcutta, change. And I was lucky if I got home at about 7 o'clock or 7:30 at night. And that was from 6 in the morning. And you did this Monday to Fridays. Saturdays, you had a half day. But you were never able to get a full round of golf in at 2 o'clock because by the time you got out, it was dark out there.
When I was invited by the mill manager over for breakfast, he usually offered you a pink gin or a gin and tonic or something of that nature with your breakfast. That was a normal thing. After all, you'd been up and you'd been working for hours. And it was getting very hot.
The Jute Wallahs would have spent half their time in the mill office, but the clatter of the looms draws me in another direction.
This is what my old man did. What this guy's doing, it's exactly what it was. And I'm not sure if the conditions were much different. Probably the same, except in Scotland, A, it wasn't so hot, and there were more clothes.
Howrah Mill is working flat out, producing environmentally friendly shopping bags for Western supermarkets. Incredibly, it's still getting a helping hand from Dundee. When this mill opened in 1890, it was fully kitted out with machinery imported from Dundee. It seems a bit like selling munitions to the enemy.
As a boy, this is the sight I remember going to school. Weavers working. These machines are the oldest machines in this mill, and they're from Dundee. But I never got this close to the noise. So this is the process of breaking down the jute, making it finer. It goes through several stages to make it really fine. And the grades go all the way back here. These are different grades. This is the coarsest grade, apparently. And then you go down. And you can see the guys here, the officers. They keep them working all the time. They don't let them slack once. If they see somebody stopping for 2 seconds, they're on them. It's tough. The targets for the day.
Our company was a highly disciplined company, a very conservative company. And they always looked at the line of discipline
The Burasab, or that's the mill manager, he would be almost the equivalent of Captain Bligh, or you know, on the old Three Masters. He could just about hang.
Let's turn the clock back to what happened in Dundee 50, 60, 70 years ago. If you did your job properly, attended work on time, you had a job. It was much the same in India. There was no industrial tribunals, there was no two verbal warnings and one written warning, and if you still didn't toe the line, you were out. Do your job properly, you were in a job. Cross the line, you're out of a job. It's just as simple as that.
I've mixed emotions about this part of my journey. I've been looking forward to seeing the working mill for myself. But now I'm here, I can't help thinking about my family and the fact that my mother was only 12 when she started working in the mills back home.
This is what my mother did, spinning. The dust that flies around. This stuff is going right in your lungs, all of it. That's what all these new workers have to put up with.
To Western eyes, this place looks like a Dickensian nightmare. The heat and dust clog your senses. But with 7 million unemployed in West Bengal, these workers count themselves among the lucky ones.
How long have you worked at this mill?
बहुत अच्छा लगते हैं. लेडीज बहुत हैं. बहुत अच्छे लगे हम लोग किए.
And do you have any children?
तीन बच्चे. बहुत खुश हैं. इसीलिए ना हम ड्यूटी करते हैं. हम लोग कहीं जाते भी नहीं हैं.
You find that's lunch hour. Everybody's sleeping all over the place, trying to catch 40 winks. So surprising when you think of the level that these people work at. Somebody once said to me, you don't know the meaning of hard work. And I used to go, oh, I'm not so sure about that. But I think today, I certainly do not know the meaning of hard work. The kind of life I lead now, and the life my parents, actually they didn't lead it for very long, but they certainly led it for the first 10 years of their working life. But it's actually to do with the fact that it's about work, hard work. My ancestors, these people, they work hard, they work day in, day out. In relationship to my mother, who never wanted to work in the mill, I agree with her. Why would you? It's tough. My father, I think it was a bit more stoical, and he just got on with it and did it. And his sisters got him out because they bought him a shop, and that was it. Chick, you're out of the mill. And I know why, because the destiny of it was horrendous.
The irony is, work gave you security. But when your working life ended, two of my great-grandparents worked all their lives and died in the poorhouse.
And is this what you work for? You know, oh dear me, the world is ill divided. Them that work the hardest are the least provided. That seems to me what doesn't change.
It's a relief to get out of the mill. There, but for the grace of God, go I.
This is a Marx estate now. It's been a Marx estate for 30 years, Calcutta. And of course, I think the Marxism here is fairly tokenist. There's still corruption, there's still exploitation, there's, everything goes on, but they're used to it. They put it down to caste, that is my place, this is where I am. And of course, this is a thing that personally I've always had the problem with. You know, I had the problem growing up in Dundee, that this is not my place. My place is where I choose to make my place. I'm an internationalist. I go here, I go there. You know, that's, I can do that now.
When you're surrounded by the poverty and clamor of the streets, it's easy to forget Calcutta is the cultural capital of India. Vast tracts of the city are in a state of semi-ruin. But as in Dundee, where the Jute barons eased their consciences by constructing grand public buildings, the Mawari mill owners have made their own contributions to the city landscape. Buildings such as the Birla Planetarium stand out amongst the crumbling remnants of the British Raj. By the start of the 20th century, Calcutta was the second largest city in the British Empire. Only London was bigger. Designed to house a million people, it was as close as you could get to a slice of Britain in India. And some of it was built to last. It's Sunday morning and I'm off to Kirk. Scottish Presbyterians played a prominent role in the running of the colonial economy. And the status of their religion is reflected in the location of their church. St. Andrew's is in the heart of colonial Calcutta, cheek by jowl with the writer's building that served as the bureaucratic headquarters of British rule. It is now home to the Chief Minister of West Bengal and remains politically sensitive. Despite my driver's efforts to beat the traffic, I'm running late. I hope the minister's not from the fire and brimstone school of preaching. India has one of the oldest Christian traditions in the world, but it is a minority religion only practiced by a tiny percentage of the population. For me, the whole tenor of Presbyterianism feels out of place here. Now the Scots have gone, this English language service isn't exactly packing them in. But one man who is here is Mr. Saheed, a retired jute mill manager who worked closely with Dundee's jute wallers.
Were the Scots tough, the bosses?
No, I don't think so. I don't. You see, I'm a Christian. I was the only Christian that became a production manager. So I had a sort of very good rapport with them. Well, when I started, it was a very peaceful thing. You see, the Scotsmen that were there, they were the supreme boss, and nobody questioned them during that time. And everybody took it in the right spirit. They realized that they cannot, you know, live in ivory towers anymore.
Yeah.
They have to integrate and, you know, interact with us and find out, because that it is coming, it was inevitable. As a matter of fact, we inherited more or less those bungalows, and we stayed in really plush bungalows. That culture we also, you know, developed. And I'm really thankful that I worked with them.
Were you invited into their homes?
No.
No?
No.
We never really mixed very much in the compounds. We know we had Indian friends, but I don't recall ever having had Indian friends to the house, or my parents having them to the house, which was an awful shame. That's something that we should have done, of course. And I must say that I have done. When we've gone back more recently, we've always made it our business and enjoyed it, the company of dining with our Indian colleagues and that. And it's super, and that should have been done, of course, a long time ago. But that's history.
Our jute wallers had considerably more social contact with their local colleagues than previous generations. Some of the Indians they worked with had even been to Dundee to study jute at the Technical College. But the closest bonds were formed at a much earlier age, between the children and their ayahs, the local nannies who looked after them.
My ayah was, although she was employed as a nanny
I really more or less thought of her almost like a granny. She was part of the family, and she was actually kind of treated that way, you know. And even when we were too old for a Naya and we went to school, my parents still kept her on, and we just see her at the weekends when we came home.
I spent more time with my Aya than, of course, my mother. So whenever I needed anything, like cotton wool, for example, or the Aya, she'd have to translate. I would say, Rui Mangta, or something, or Kana Mangta, my food, and the Aya would have to translate that back to my mother. And that went on for a year or two anyway.
Well, the Ayas, they would take them out and play with them and that. See, for a European, it was too hot. The Ayas seemed to... Well, that was their country, and they could take them out and keep them in the shade and things like that.
The Tolly Gunge is an oasis of calm in the centre of Calcutta and has been a private members' club since the end of the 19th century. Its colonial traditions were so firmly entrenched that the first Indian members weren't admitted till 30 years after their country gained its independence. I'm here to meet Samita Dutt, one of the few Bengali businesswomen to work in the contemporary jute industry. Her father was one of the first Indians to manage a mill.
Do you remember the Scottish people?
Oh, yes, I do. I mean, they had a wonderful life. They really had, you know, there was parties, and I remember watching from, you know, from the stairs. You know, my mom, she's actually a very traditional Bengali girl from Purulia.
Yeah.
But, you know, with coming in contact with, you know, this kind of life,
yeah,
she started her whiskey and her cigarettes and...
So the Dundonis were a corrupting influence.
Yeah. I think my parents had a great time.
There's also this feeling of a kind of reserve that may have come from the Indian side rather than what I'd led to be was the Scottish side in social relationships.
I think our family, I think we were particularly sort of comfortable because we were more westernized than most Indians.
Right.
But I don't know if that's always a good thing, but, well, that's the way we were, I mean.
Why do you think that's not always a good thing?
Because there's a lot of Indian culture that, you know, that perhaps I haven't imbibed personally. For instance, jute now.
Yeah.
The owners are all now Marwaris. And they are very, very traditional. You know, they're mostly vegetarians. They're not into drinking. And their culture is different, you know.
Yeah.
They are now running the jute mills, and you know.
Does that make you quite unique as a jute? I mean, you must be unique in your position.
I wouldn't know, but I'm maybe a bit of an oddball, yeah.
Yeah.
You know.
The jute wallers were living a life of previously unimagined luxury, but this did not guarantee them entry into clubs like the Tolly Gunge. As far as the Calcutta establishment was concerned, they were mere box wallers, tradesmen on the bottom rung of the social ladder. Class divisions such as this were rife among the British in India, and surprisingly, even extended into the mills themselves.
Well, there was a sort of social ladder, so to speak, and you found that the bankers tended to stick together, and then, of course, in the mills themselves, the crannies, the office masters, so to speak, they always put themselves on a higher plane than the others. And
there was very little to and fro in between the mill manager, and there was a huge then gap to the assistant mill manager, and then to the assistants, another huge gap. And even socially, certainly in the early days, they would not really mix at all.
The Scottish Cemetery in central Calcutta is one place where all Scots were equal. By 1890, there were an astonishing 3,000 Dundonians working in Bengal's mills. This cemetery stands as evidence that their lives were far from easy.
Yeah, jutes are all that side in the hand.
Jutes are all this side?
Yeah.
Wow.
The financial rewards of working in Calcutta were high, but so were the costs. Many who came
did not make it home.
John Clark, born in Dalser, Scotland. Mm. We've got one here. What's this one? Oh, in loving memory of Charles William Lowe. Willie Lowe, my God. Moneyfeith, Forfarshire, Scotland. Born in Moneyfeith. We were at Moneyfeith. You know, there's a club in Moneyfeith called the Calcutta and Mafussel Society, which are all Dundonians who came, who worked here in the 50s.
The roll call here reads like a gathering of the clans, surnames like Anderson, McGregor, Campbell, Urquhart, and Ross.
Norman, how many people do you think would be here?
1,600. Out of 1,600, 600 graves have been demolished. Wow. So that's all.
1,600?
Yeah.
That's unbelievable. How do you feel about this, Norman? How do you feel personally?
We feel okay over here. Nothing to worry about anything over here.
You're nothing to worry about?
No.
I'm glad there's nothing to worry about.
Nothing
but
to worry
when
about.
You see such wastage, what do you feel, you know? Or you just say, oh, well.
Just let it be, let it
What's
go
that? There's a wonderful Indian expression.
Yeah.
What is that Indian expression?
Just let it come up.
Yeah, but there's a one, is it in Bengali, there's something about such is life.
Yeah. Such a jaisi hai usi chalne do.
What?
Jaisi hai usi chalne do.
Jesse Hai Osi Changado. Jesse Hai Osi Changado. Well, definitely there's a lot of Changado around here.
Yeah.
So, what have we got here? Oh, it's hot.
Very warm, it is.
Very warm.
Calcutta is a very, very warmy place, this
Yeah,
is.
I think
very
I'll
hot
to,
place. This
I think
is.
I'm going to have to change my code of dress. So, in the memory of James Luke. Born Broughty Ferry. Broughty Ferry is just right next to where I come from. He will be remembered, but only just. After all those years of working and building up an industry, and this is what you come to.
William Shakespeare, as ever, put it best. Fear no more the heat of the sun, nor the furious winter's rages. Thou thy worldly task hast done. Home art gone, and ta'en thy wages. Golden lads and girls all must, as chimney sweepers, come to dust. Norman and his family live in the cemetery's tiny single-roomed gatehouse. He invites me back to examine the records.
Sure. This is the logbook of the
cemetery.
Of the cemetery, of
yeah.
all the inhabitants.
Cemetery.
Now, it must be very quiet at night here.
Yeah, very quiet.
Very peaceful.
It's very nice having kind of neighbors like that,
very
isn't
peaceful.
It? Having neighbors who don't make a noise. Oh, I see. Oh, and here are the workers. Here's the assistant manager, Jute Mills. Mm. Overseer. Reliance Jute Mills. Yeah, dysentery, typhoid. Life was really tough. I mean, really, really tough. It's extraordinary to think that the life of these people, I mean, they were so not used to working in this kind of climate.
Yeah.
Typhoid again. There's cholera. Assistant manager Jute Mills. I mean, the last entry here is 2007.
Yeah, that's the priestess. John Thomas's. That's the last doctor.
That's the last people?
Last year, yeah.
So there's still people being buried. And this is just 2 years ago?
Yeah.
Wow.
This is my last day in Calcutta. And my visit to the Scottish cemetery has been a chilling reminder of how fragile life in this tropical climate could be for the Dundonians. The Calcutta Scottish Heritage Trust is restoring the cemetery. But what of the reputation of the Jute Wallers? How are they remembered in the Indian history books? I'm off to meet Dr. Sumita Sen, a leading Bengali historian.
What do you think the legacy of the Dundonian workers is?
There's absolutely no doubt that the industry in Calcutta were built by Scotsmen. From Dundee. They brought the expertise. A great deal of the investment initially came from Dundee. The initial machinery was imported from Dundee. And if you go down the river northward from Calcutta, the mark of the industry is everywhere. It was central to Bengal's agriculture, it was central to Bengal's trade, and it was the largest industry of Bengal. The industry itself, I think, is the legacy of Dundonian workers.
We were both very fortunate, the pair of us and the family in India. Really, we never had a bad experience. And we look back and say, I wish I'd gone out there years beforehand.
It was a good life. Mm-hmm. It was good to us. We enjoyed it.
It gave us a start to life, like.
I think India is a country that you either love or you don't settle down at all. And quite a number who went out just couldn't face the heat and the humidity and so on. But on the other hand, I must say I enjoyed every minute I was out there.
I was a wee lassie from Lochee going out there, and it was just great, you know, learning everything. And lots of people feel the same way, you know, when they go out first. And then you come back and you realise how lucky you've been to have experienced all that.
After 20 years or so, you became so accustomed to the climate and the way of life that here, very difficult to settle here.
So, here we are on the Hooghly. The Hooghly and the Tay. This is where the Dundonians would arrive when they came from Dundee. They would arrive here in the Hooghly. They'd arrive just over there. And this is where they would leave from. For me, I had all kinds of opinions, you know, and suppositions about things, which I had to learn to shift. Partly to do with my own, locked into my own family history and what that was about and who I was and where I came from and how my family were exploited and how the Jute barons behaved and all of that. I think every man is affected by his sense of journey and where he goes to and where he comes from and trying to make sense of who he is and what his purpose is. That's where you take the ticket and go. It was Stevenson said, I travel not to go anywhere but to go. The great affair is to move. Another boat coming in.
Recent encounters to more memorable moments from the archives, famous faces in conversation, choosing their Desert Island Discs. Listen now on BBC Sounds.